Hi YouTube. Well, as you can probably tell, I made it back safe and sound. Wow, it's cold out there. There's nothing like a touch of alcohol to take the chill away. Yes, this is a new hip flask. As you can probably see, from Celtic marches. Now you can look them up on the internet. This is filled with bloody furlong liqueur. They do a number of different liqueurs and all the rest of it on the website. Bloody furlong is named after the field where a battle was fought in the mid 1600s, and Celtic marches now own that field. And some of what goes in here is grown on that field. Hence they've given it that name, and it tastes a bit hot as well. Not curry hot, but it can definitely warm the cockles of your heart on a cold morning. I decided to do that because it's the ideal thing to have around in the camera case when I'm doing those dawn and dusk shoots. It'll be handy to have around. But anyway, that's probably going to be a link in the hoo-ha bar. There's going to be a number of links in the hoo-ha bar from this lot, I tell you. Now, the food fair was number two, day two of three, for which the BBC Good Food Show was in Olympia, which is in London. Now, it's a relatively large sort of hall area, and I've been there before for a few other events, shall we say. But this one was the first time I've been to any sort of food show event in the Olympia. It was a bit awkward getting there, especially on a weekend, because they typically do all their... Hello again. As you can probably work out, I suffered a microphone failure when it dropped off my dressing gown. So, although I was able to save some of that recording and just do a simple amplification job on it, the majority of the recording, unfortunately, was toast. Potted rabbit on toast. So I've got to try and re-record all this and re-say what I was saying. Right, let's get to a certain area and a certain list. Going to London was an event in itself. It's a bit odd if you're trying to spend all day at an event, though, because typically you don't see that much of London. There's a lot going on inside it. You get in, get to your venue, spend the day, and then you get out of London again. It's pretty much dark at this time of year. But on the bus in, we did see a few bits and pieces. We saw the Route Master, the new Route Master, was one example. Now, in the old days, the Route Master buses had two people on board. They had the driver and they had the Clippy. Clippy because of the clip machine to take the tickets. Long story. There were two people on the bus, and the bus was actually open at the back end. So if the bus was just about to pull off, you could just hop onto the thing and the Clippy could handle your fare while the driver concentrated on the driving. In later years, we changed to this one driver system. They tried to save on staff. But now we seem to be in a time when there's more trouble on the buses and all the rest of that jazz. So they're going back to the two system. They're going back to new Route Master buses. And there's very few of them around in London at the moment. I've been told that there's a lot more on order. But yeah, the Route Master is making a comeback. How they're handling disabled access on those kind of buses, I don't know. But as you saw, we just saw one as it pulled up, stopped for a little while and vanished off again. We didn't exactly have time to ask questions. As they start to flood London a bit more, we'll generally get to know more about them. We also got to see the full dress rehearsals, just from the bus. of all the military in all the red, you know, dress uniforms on the backs of the horses, ready for the remembrance parades today. By the time, you know, on a bus, you can see it, but by the time you've actually got a camera out, flipped it into a recording mode, you know, it's gone. So, unfortunately, I couldn't bring you any of that. There were an awful lot of people at Olympia. Not as many as I've seen for some other events, shall I say. But there was an awful lot of people. The lower section was where most of the food, alcohol, and, well, the strong alcohol, and all the kitchen appliances and all the rest of that were located. There were a few stalls there who, in my opinion, shouldn't have been there. Places like Virgin Media, they were there, for example, and a few others. But, you know, we managed to get in after all that, planned our route, and lo and behold, one of the things on my shopping list was some more Thunder Vodka. And that was pretty much one of the first stalls that we came across.
Oh yeah, breakfast.
Yeah, so that was £20, £21 immediately gone from my purse. Actually, I paid by credit card. Yeah, oh well. So down that aisle was a lot of liqueurs and things, and indeed, coming back up another way and dotted a few other places, there were a lot of stronger liqueurs. Further down, we came across this, which was 43, and I've got to put that on there. I think they call it Live 43. No, sorry, Liquor 43. And it's LICOR43.com. I'll show you that briefly. The camera's focus is responding a lot faster. That's because I've got daylight in. And the incredible thing about this is that you can mix it with various things. The one that caught me was Blanco 43, which is one part of Liquor 43 and three parts of cold milk. You got loads of little recipes like that. And they had a number of these mixes on display, so you could taste them. I'm going to see how I do long term, because by the time I got there, you know, my palate was pretty much wiped out and I was already yeah, through some of the strength of this alcohol that we were testing. Other liqueurs of note, Thornton's, the chocolate people, have their own chocolate liqueur. Now, I wasn't too taken back, too struck with it. I'm going to see how I get on with it. That's there, you know, we've got long drinks. It's a Thornton's White Russian, Thornton's Shake, you know. You know, they're all coming up with various recipes. In other words, what you could probably... Thornton's Hot Chocolate. Add 25ml of liqueur to your hot chocolate, adding fresh cream and chocolate sprinkles for a superbly indulgent experience. You know, stuff like that. There's all sorts of bits and pieces that you can do. I suppose what I'm going to do is see how this fits in with my life, and I'm not expecting it to do great things, but I'm going to give it a chance. Among the others on the liqueur side, there was also a Welsh toffee liqueur, but I don't think they quite had. I'm not sure, because I think where they suffered was that the in the competition stakes is that the Thunder vodka, toffee vodka, absolutely glorious, I love it, had a chiller, and they were serving the demos chilled, whereas the Welsh stand there that wasn't, but there was another Welsh stand there, condesa.u.co.uk. Most of these links will be in the hoo-ha bar at some point. This is they had a number of things. The Welsh creams attracted me. This is the praline version. I bought two bottles, so I got a small one free. They had another one, which is a standard cream. I bought one of each. The standard cream tasted more like Bailey's, pretty much. So I'm going to have to work out the pricing, because it may be cheaper to get theirs than the Baileys, you know. Coming close to Christmas, things start to get on offer, and then you've got to work out the prices. These supermarkets are a real pain in the neck in some cases. Yeah, so I think that just about does it for the liqueurs at the bottom that I was actually interested in. One of the other stands that really was there that shouldn't be. Oh no, there was. Well, that was upstairs. In case I don't talk about this later on in the video, I can't remember. The Bluebell, if you know the Bluebell Railway near here, they actually have their own vineyard. Bluebell Vineyard Estates, and that was a nice touch of alcohol. I'm not sure, that was my favourite of them. That's another one that hopefully will be on the list, is it? No, I'm going to have to make sure that that's on the list as well. What have I got to put on the bleeding list? Ah, that's got to go on. Oh, I need that later. and the other one. Where did I chuck that? God. As you can see, oh, there it is. Safe and sound. Right, those have got to go on the list as well. Among the other stores that shouldn't have been there, in my personal opinion, is the Royal Mint. They actually have a demo bus that they've driven in and parked up. It takes no... well, a friend of mine has been a coin collector for some considerable years, and his opinion of the Royal Mint is that they've ramped up the number of lines that they're doing. You know, the number of commemorative coins, or this coin special, that coin, and the quality has hit the deck. You know, everything pretty much is bright and circulated now. What they're selling as a proof coin is pretty much just bright uncirculated, in his opinion. And I think he's right. Having seen the quality of the coins, I think the Royal Mint have gone straight down the toilet. So collecting British coins is pointless. Right, let's actually move on to some of the foodie stuff. I didn't buy any of the gadgets. There were shed loads of gadgets there. One of which I've never seen any use for, is the bin, which you have to, you wave at the bin and the bin opens. You then toss whatever you got into the bin and then wave it again and it'll close. You're approaching the damn thing with a hand, with your hands full of rubbish anyway. How the heck, what are you going to use to wave at the bin? No, don't even think about it. Not on this channel. You'll get me struck off with thoughts like that. Among the other things that were there were things that I didn't bother with, and this is one of them, Flora Tea. Like, if you're into really odd things, these basically infusions, and they come up with plants or whatever the heck. Mayflowers, flower lover, lily fairy, all sorts of different stuff. I couldn't be asked for them because they, you know, what's the point? Once discovered, never forgotten. I think I've put Flora Tea on there. It's up to you to have a look at it and see whether or not you're interested in that kind of stuff. It didn't float my boat. What did were a number of things. Now, I'm not a particular fan of chocolate. I'm trying to kick the chocolate bug. But if you're after something... Now, Black River Chocolates. These people... That what I did taste tasted nice. It was dark chocolate, wasn't necessary to my taste, but it tasted crisp. It had flavour tones, aftertones, etc. This lot do not want to go into the supermarkets because they say the supermarkets are killing them on margin. They're trying to find any small stores, shops, or anything to carry them. So if you happen to know of any small, if you like your chocolate, and you want to get it on a regular basis, and you want to persuade some shop owners to have a look into this, that's the address. Have a look at their products. There's a QR code bar thing as well there. I can't, holding this up, I can't actually see my own viewfinder when I've got this up, so I don't even know if that's worked. Now, hopefully, it being a QR code, it should also work that way. I can't hold it steady enough. Well, if you can pause it and get your thing to see that, then good luck. most of the foods there were geared towards the high end. So we're talking, I don't remember seeing a single bread stall there. It was pretty much all the high end cake stuff, which I tend to turn off to these days. You know, I'm not an over fan of cake. They're nice now and then. One very interesting thing that was happening there was this company, Sponge, and they were selling these. little boxes of sponge, you know, a little cake you can get. You can just, that's it in my hand for you to get an idea of size, 1 pound. And I just ate that as I was going around. The only problem is it with the height on it, and getting my jaw wide enough to eat the thing. Very tasty. They do larger ones. And our sponge on there, I think they've got a website. Yeah, sponge.co.uk. And this is the family, apparently. They do all sorts of bits and pieces. There was another cake stand there that also caught my eye. I didn't try anything because by that time I pretty much spent all my cash. Let's flatten that. And that was the Little Round Cake Company. Now, their round cakes were a bit cheaper than Sponge in terms of the size of the cake to what they were asking, which was, you know, it was quite a nice, reasonably sized cakes, and I think they were only asking £2.25 for them. And again, you could have had them in your hands while you're eating it. It was a bit much to get a grip on. And again, Little Round Cake Company, they've got a QR code, and there's a winner free cake delivery every month for a year at their new website. That's the QR code, and that's the URL. So if you like your cakes, you're not going to face too much competition from me because I'm not going to be entering. Now, to the more standard foods. sorry. One of the interesting ones was Peppersmith. Now, if you like your peppermint, you might be interested in these, depending. Because for a start, they're sugar-free. We've only got the mints. They're sugar-free. They're aspartame-free. So if you have problems with those kinds of things, and you like your mints, have a look into these. They've got a sense of humour. They also do gums and other things as well. And I think I've got... Oh, there it is. They've got a sense of humour. Peppersmith, a beginner's guide to making a mint. I'm not kidding. A beginner's guide to making a mint. And they've got where they source their products from, all the rest of it. And we've even got a 25% voucher off for anything that's bought online. So sometimes these fares are pretty good if you're intending on becoming a long-term customer. Talking about becoming a long-term customer, as I said in one of the videos, I'm actually now a member of a Sausage Club. I have my Sausage Club members pack. And it's with Supreme Sausages. Now, there were a number of sausage manufacturers there, but very few of them actually cooking up sausage. So I had a taste of these. They've got quite a range. This is the range of sausages. They do other things as well. Some of them are interesting. They also do a lamb and mint sausage. So if you've got problems with pork, they have got some alternatives. And the firm was started by Paul Garnish. Great surname if you're in this sort of, in that sort of business. He trained as a butcher. The whole business, the history, is established in 1990. Not that old a firm, but he basically had experience from other areas. Now, what this company is doing is not too bad. I mean, we've got the problem of maintaining. Supply of reasonable products or good products, you know, in the local area we're pretty much stuck. We've got the supermarkets, but the supermarkets are limiting our choice. And also, when I go on about wine, the supermarkets can't bridge that gap. Incidentally, later on I do go on about wine, and I go on about this DVD, John Cleese Wine for the Confused. I found it this morning. I don't know if you're going to be able to find it. Who actually put in it? Yeah, it was seen on the Food Network, which I think is American. There's the ISBN number if you want it and you can try and find it. But basically, the long story short is when it comes to wine, I haven't got a clue. I'm wholly reliant on other people, but I say that in the other part. You see, the problem is you come away from these shows and you're wondering, okay, there's some great stuff, really quality stuff that is worth paying that little bit extra for, but how the heck do I get it? How am I going to merge it into my daily diet. And it's not easy. But being a member of the Sausage Club, they will do 2 deliveries to you a year. The membership gives you access to 20 packets of sausages, which aren't that much, but once I tasted the quality, I was up for it. I'm certainly going to give it a shot. Once everything is cleared, I'm expecting an email Monday or Tuesday. I can then pick what sausages I want in my first load, and they deliver them. There's more information on the website as to how they deliver and all the rest of that jazz. And there's a couple of other things that you do once you've joined the Sausage Club. For a start, you get a membership card, which I don't know where the heck that's gone now. Paperwork around here has a tendency to vanish, which will give you a little bit of discount. I don't know how much, on if you get a sausage, if you get something to eat there from them to eat at the fair, which some cases is in some cases is quite good, because you know you will need something to spend it. You know, if you're taking the edge off. How much discount? I don't know. I'll find out next time I bump into them at a fair. Which is entirely possible, because another aspect of membership is when they go to these fairs, and they go to about 160 odd of them a year, the organisers sometimes dish out free tickets for them to give out to people to encourage people to go to the fair. And what they do is they put a certain number of them, first come, first served, up to the membership, up to the club membership. So, there's a chance of getting free entry into some of the fairs. Now, I presume that different people will have different different fair preferences. My own preference would be for something more local, because, you know, the local one that we went to had a lot more food in it. Some of the firms were notable by their absence. I didn't see Sussex Charmer at this one, for example, or some of the fudge stores. You know, they just weren't there. The bread was missing. So I'd typically want to be going to some of the more local food fairs. But yeah, that's that. The sausage membership pack. Give that a look. It's worthwhile. I found this lot again. They were on my shopping list. Jilly's balsamic dressing. Gillies, whatever. There's the web address. It is in the list. I know that one. And this is absolutely great on salads. Beautiful. I love it. If you see them on the stall, just grab a piece of demo bread, dip it in, have a taste. Gorgeous. One of the stalls that was there that I didn't buy from this time was the smokehouse. Yeah, I mean, there were some absolutely wonderful smells, wonderful flavours. But it was a problem merging them into the everyday diet. Couldn't really get around that. I think they've got to step up their access, getting access to some of this stuff, and some of this stuff is pretty expensive. So yeah, not that easy. Last on the food store is BritishFineFoods.com. Possibly worth looking into for the delivery. They actually have one. Oh, as you can see, the winner of Best Food Mail Order Supplier 2010. You know, it's going to be companies like this that might actually, aggregation companies that bring things in and then send them to you, you know, sort of like a mail order supermarket for better quality and local foods. That might actually help. I think what I would like to see is a cross of everything, to be perfectly honest. I would like somewhere that's within reasonable commuting distance. I mean, I don't want necessarily have to have things within 5 miles. But if there was a sort of an organised local food supermarket. I know we've got farmers markets. But they're pretty ad hoc. Some of them are not liked for their location. There was going to be one in Haywards Heath starting up, but a local religious group decided to put the markers on it. They didn't want it that close to them, especially on a certain day of the week, and that completely foobarred that. Thanks. But anyway, there you go. Sometimes there's a great sense of humour and other opportunities. Sense of humour, how about this? From a fish stall. Yeah, warning, smoking is seriously addictive, even if it is just the odd trout. Oh, you gotta have a sense of humour. But there was, one of the links is going to be to seafoodtraining.org. Now, some of the things that go on at these shows, I'm not a big lover of strong fish. I can't handle it. But we did have some very nice scallops for dinner, which were, or lunch, or whatever the heck you want to call it. Not very many of them, but they were fried very nicely. I know that fish is one of those things that I need to build into my diet, but I shy away from it. Fortunately, Mum put it in the diet, so it is part of things, but I want to try and get over some of these things. I've started eating beetroot again, which I never used to like, because it's a very strong, earthy flavour. I don't like strong flavours. But when I looked at the alternative lists to get the various nutritional that I need, beetroot is pretty much on the list. And so I want to try and do the same with fish. So I signed myself up for the low level of chance of actually getting on a fish course, because I said to the person, look, if I'm going to do it, I'm going to need to be in the hands of someone who actually knows what they're doing and can actually adjust things, can actually knows what they're talking about and can actually help me through this, because the supermarkets, you know, they can't do that. That they can't bridge the gap. There is a gap there between the food suppliers and us, the consumers, and the supermarkets have just basically cut that. The only way you can get some of that expertise, if you go into places like butchers, fishmongers, that sort of thing. And then again, some of these people, you know, they're in a retail environment. Their business is to sell. That's where they make their money. And they can't spend too much time mollycoddling someone who really doesn't know what they're talking about. So, to some of these aspects, training is going to be needed. I think that's about it for the food. I think there was something else that... Oh, yes. I didn't mention in this video the potted game, which I was eating at the start of this. And I did find... they were also on my shopping list. I immediately found the stall, handed over 20 quid and said, give me that, and that. They actually managed to answer a question that I had, which was, look, the stuff says previously frozen, and previously frozen do not refreeze, so you couldn't refreeze it. And I mentioned it in the last one, but basically if you buy on the stand, you can't refreeze it because they've already frozen it to get it there. But yes, if you do buy the stuff online, they deliver it in a reasonable quantity, about 10 pots minimum, and then you can stick it in your freezer. So yeah, this stuff... I think I'll. I'm not sure about the rabbit. I think I'll. The wood pigeon I got again, and I decided to go for the wild boar this time. So we'll see what happens. I got two pots of each. Great on toast. Anyway, right. I think that was about it for the food section. Not very much, to be perfectly honest, or not very much that. Not very much that could satisfy me on a day in, day out basis. Then, prior to going upstairs, we attended Ollie Smith. Now, I know in some of my videos, some of the people milling around and ducking in, you know, distracted me, and I said Oz Smith is another wine expert, but Ollie Smith, a pretty bubbly character, and he was running a seminar on, or whatever it is, on a half-hour slot, whatever you want to call it, I don't know, on food and wine, and matching wine to food and all the rest of it. And He's pretty much of the opinion that education needs to be fun, needs to be entertaining, so that it sticks in your mind. And that's pretty much the same thing that one of the things that John Cleese was saying about when he founded his training company some years ago. And basically, oh boy, he did start off as fun.
I'm speaking to you from my mountain lair, where I'm currently engaged on a top secret mission for UNICEF. I am, of course, Oyster's biggest fan, and he's definitely not forcing me to say any of this. It is quite untrue that he is blackmailing me, and Molly is really a decent fellow, and I'm looking forward immensely to spending my holiday with him next year. And the year after that. I hope you enjoyed the show as much as I already am. Please, welcome to the stage, Holly Smith.
Hello, nice to see you all. I can't reach you all, but consider this a great big hug and a high five from me. Here we are. Now, the next half an hour is going to be about sharing my great passion, obviously, for wine, but also using wine as an ingredient and then pairing wines with dishes. I should reassure you, in case you're wondering, I am Ollie, the guy off Saturday Kitchen who does the wines, but I've just lost 3.5 stone in weight. Thank you very much. Look at that. Hurrah. I adore wine. I think it's the most glorious thing in the world. Depending on where it comes from, who makes it, it can taste different. There is a wine out there for every palate and every pocket. And hopefully in this show, we'll show you a little bit more about embracing the spirit of adventure, pairing up with different dishes, extra enjoyment for free. Now, before we get started, a bit of a celebration, I thought. I demonstrate how to open a phenomenal bottle of fizz. Now, when you're at home, the way to open a bottle of fizz is, of course, to turn it on its side very, very gently, to turn the bottle, not the cork, and unleash it really quietly. It should come out just like a sigh, because you don't want all of those bubbles and all of that wonderful fizz to pour out. You don't want to waste it. You want it to go in here to taste that delicacy, those wonderful pinprick bubbles. However, this is cooking with wine. And I thought I would do it with a sword. But to be honest, ladies and gents, you get some funny looks if you walk around Kensington with a sword. So today, for your pleasure, I will endeavour to open this with a blade! I know. Are you ready? Drum roll, if you please. Look at that! But I made a mess! If only there was someone here who could clean it up! It's one sheet!
Are you spilling that beautiful champagne again?
I can't believe I've done it! I'm so...
Is that your party trick again?
Yeah, I'm sorry, it is my party trick. Please will you help look at this, ladies and gentlemen. Look, they can't see, but... Juan, can you turn around and just show them? I don't know if you can... The camera's there. Yes, I think that... There you are. This is what we're talking about. Get your YouTube videos up, marvellous.
This is such a messy puppy, but you are so talented about wine and so beautifully handsome. I cannot be on the stage and be upstairs. All the telly box. Good show, you handsome devil.
Grazie.
Don't forget.
One sheep does plenty. We love you, one sheep. Thank you for coming. Listen, I'm going to pour some fizz. How amazing is he? You should see what he gets up to backstage. We had to crowbar him into that lycra. So, I'm going to get a little friend of mine on right now to come and help me do some cooking on the stage.
Yeah, boy, that was fun. He also invited the audience to tweet him on stage, to tweet questions to him. But we couldn't. I mean, I certainly couldn't, because, my phone was giving the transmission pulses, but it wasn't telling me that I was getting anything back. I'm pretty sure that my phone, mobile phone, was being squelched. Jammed, however you want to put it. But we did have to stick our hands up. And my friend sat next to me, stuck her hand up and asked a question. And she got a kiss as a result and went very red in the face.
Champagne, you like to try it. Now you have to tell everybody how that tastes, because I'm happy with it, but she's not, I'm stuffed.
Happy days? Top notch, Johnny.
Top notch, there you go. High fives and here's a kiss. Thank you. Wonderful. So, champagne, absolutely right. It's a lovely match with cheese.
She won't forget that in a hurry. When we finished there, it was time to move upstairs to where the wine show was going on, and a lot of wine tasting. Now, I've never had much luck with wines, to the extent where I found myself watching a John Cleese video, which is a bit difficult to find, about wine tasting. Now, I've tried to find the DVD myself, and it's not in the cupboard, so it must already be in this room somewhere, which means I might find it sometime before the year's out, if I'm lucky. But what John Cleese was saying in understanding wine is that rather than trying to understand all these different areas and the histories of it, is to try and describe what you like and what you hate about the tastes and your tastes and how various wines affect you, what flavours come through, that sort of thing. And among the things he did was some very interesting tests, one of which was a number of people were given some unidentified wine in a bottle that they couldn't see through, so they couldn't see the wine that they were drinking. They were asked to drink it, and then they were asked to question how many thought they were drinking white wine, to stick their hands up, and how many thought they were drinking red wine, to stick their hands up. It was roughly 50-50, if I remember correctly, and he dropped the bombshell that they were all drinking the same wine. So the wine is only one part of the equation, our taste is another part. Now, he did explain in the DVD how certain wines get the tastes that they get, and how things can vary from change from year to year in the same crop even, and how various factors can affect things. And, well, it's very helpful to understand that, but for someone like me who will probably never have the time to go into the in-depth side of this, pretty much the only way forward is to use a wine merchant and to build a reputation with a wine merchant and explain to that wine merchant the kinds of things that you like and you don't like. And that's pretty much impossible to do in a supermarket. And in some wine stores, you know, they're just manned by people who, you know, just know how to grab the item, scan it, and charge you the right price. I was a bit miffed when, in the next town, there was a wine merchant, and yeah, the people in there knew their wines, they knew their stuff. But unfortunately, I know that I couldn't put very much money their way. Eventually, the shop itself shut, and that's left me with a bit of a wine dilemma. I'm fortunate in that a number of my friends know about their wines, and that's where some of these wines have actually come from. And this is the latest one to tickle my fancy. Very nice wine, Hungarian. Yeah, I don't know if you can read that. So, I think that's pretty much the only way that I'll go forward with wines, and matching them up to various bits and pieces. Now, there are some various rules as to what kinds of wines go with what kinds of meals, and the purposes of some of them. Like some of the wines with large tannic bases are there to cut through the palate if you've had a very fatty meal, you know. And they were used in certain times. But, you know, that brings another question of how our palates are going to change for a more healthier lifestyle and what that's going to mean for the wine that matches them. See what happens. But to the wine tasting itself, okay, you get a little bag to hang around your neck to put your glass in. But, you know, you were drinking a number of different wines and they were all over the place, and how on earth you were supposed to make some sort of decision about them, especially as I've got a cold, or I'm recovering from a cold, and, you know, smell and taste aren't exactly what they should be. So for me, wine tastings like that aren't really the way forward for a lot of it. You know, the wine merchants seem to be working from, well, I think they're working from stereotype in some cases, because, you know, they jump from person to person who's turning up at the stall who they think is going to wind up parting with cash, and, you know, they can wind up ignoring people who are prepared to spend quite a considerable bit of cash, but they buggered up the sale because they didn't give someone the right attention, and it's sort of understandable given the numbers of people that are coming through. So, you know, it's not the best environment in which to try wines, test them out, and, you know, it's too much people, really. There is only one. That there still really only remains the one way forward, as far as I can see, with wine tasting, and that is to build up a relationship with a merchant who can then build up a picture of what you like, and when they come across particular wines that they think you might like, you know, tip you off to them. Obviously, you've got to run the balance between how many of these merchants will actually ship you stuff for the hell of shipping it. So we're not into it. I'm not talking wine clubs here, which, you know, you pay 40 quid for membership and you get a case of so and so. You know, you're still left to sort it all out for yourself. But I think that a good wine merchant can, you know, can be pretty much worth a weight in gold. If you're like me, haven't got much of a clue. Haven't got much time or resource to have much of a clue, and need to pretty much get something that you're going to like within a few hits, really. So, that day is over. I'm going to compile this and get this lot out to you, and catch you in the next video. Take care, you two. Bye.